What's
Hello.
up? It's a
How's it
nice
going?
you with the long hair, man.
Dude, not like an option anymore.
How's it going?
Going all right. This used to be kind of our lifestyle, but now it's kind of getting a little boring. Because,
True.
we can't do those little dinners here and there, and that's, I think, the more pissing off part than anything else.
Very true. Very, very true. But how's everything otherwise? What's been keeping you busy?
TV?
Yeah.
I don't think we're ever going to get like a time like this again to just chill out. So I'm not putting stress on myself. I don't think anybody should be putting stress on themselves right now. Maybe just get some sun. That should be the priority of our lives right now.
Very true. But yeah, so today, so this was Ashit's idea. I'm not going to take credit for it, but he came up with the idea saying that, why not talk about the cameras that we've used and talk about cameras in general. So I was like, I can't think of any other bigger camera geeks, at least in the, in my peers and in Bombay and stuff. So I was like, cool, it's a good idea since we both have owned at least 2 dozen cameras each. So yeah, before we start getting a watch, it all costs and all that. It costs a lot of money, but it's I feel yeah, they are tools, but at the same time they there's something so exciting about trying something new, especially if it makes a job easier. So
It's a very good point about them being tools, right? Because we just say, okay, they're tools, and that we end the conversation there.
correct.
But they're very specific tools for very specific genres of photography, which we don't kind of pay attention to. And we're told by everybody that, they're just tools and you shouldn't think too much about them. But they do have a very specific requirement sometimes, and we tend to ignore that because also we're trying to not make that a bigger deal than it is.
True, very, very true. So yeah, we definitely come under a lot of criticism regularly about, oh my God, selling cameras, you're buying cameras, how much money has your dad given you and all that. It's all a little like,
How much
oh
money has your dad given
yeah, I can.
you?
Like, oh my God, you're so lucky. So I'm like, dude, I've been doing this for the last like 10, 12 years. Now I can kind of barely afford to, like, buy the latest in whatever in terms of camera gear. But so what we'll do today is, since this is the first episode, we just want to talk about the cameras
Sorry,
we use.
Gaurav, just excuse me 1 second. Is there somebody at the door? Sorry, one
No,
second.
go for it. I'll start our intro. But what we want to talk about, Krisha, is basically how what all cameras we have owned, the experience we have had with cameras over the last 10, 12 years. It's been years for me. I don't know how long has it been for you, Ashit?
Sorry, I didn't hear any of that.
Since you started your career, or started, when was the first time you picked up a camera?
So I think my first camera I picked up in 2006.
Okay.
That was the Olympus OM10. But yeah, it's been about like I think what 14 years now.
So I started my career in 2008, but yeah, I picked up like a DSLR or a film camera back in 2006 around the same time.
Yeah, no, the same. Because I didn't call myself a professional photographer until I started shooting for money. The actual word of professional versus amateur, right? Because
That makes
yeah,
sense.
so I didn't call myself like I feel like a lot of people just tend to call themselves professional photographers right out of as soon as they get the camera. But for me, it was more important to start shooting commercial work than the label.
Great.
So I took that a little bit more literal than most people do. But yeah.
That's cool. Okay, so what we'll do is, I think let's start with Ashit because this was his idea.
Hey,
And
the name is your idea, okay?
okay, the name,
Isonation was
yeah, name is my
Gaurav's
idea,
idea.
but I think this is just honestly a very fun, easy, casual conversation about cameras. It's especially in times like this where everyone is stressing about, oh my God, what do you do for the world? The world is coming to an end, etc. This is just our way of kind of having fun with it. I know most of us can't even afford to buy new cameras right now because the market is so bad, we don't have work. But there's no point in, there's no harm in dreaming and fantasizing about the latest and greatest and all this thing. So without further ado, what camera do you want to start with, Ashit? You were telling me about your.
Should we start with our first cameras so that it makes, I mean, it gives a kind of.
Let me start with yours because I have a folder set for you. Give me a second.
So, I mean, so I'll talk about my first camera. So, I think the first camera that I got was Olympus OM10.
Okay,
this
nice.
Camera was, yeah, so I bought this camera. I don't know, I think your picture is kind of covering a dial.
I'm sorry.
Part of the that's okay. I don't think you can move it.
So, okay, yo.
Yeah. Is that... yeah, so there's a little dial next to the thing, the lens, the little round thing next to the lens. Correct. So that didn't come with my camera.
Okay.
So my camera was, so basically you buy the camera without that one aspect, okay? So it's a, I didn't know at that point, but it's only an aperture priority camera. Like it did not do anything but shoot aperture priority.
I didn't know that, wow.
Yeah, and I didn't know that either. I didn't know what shutter speed and aperture. I just went and bought a camera. I went to the equivalent of, I don't know if you have like a Dubai Plaza around here, like kind of like the gray market areas.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
There's one near Haji Ali, right? So I went to one of those places and I picked up a camera.
No question. So Krisha and Aryavad, we'll answer all the questions in the second half in probably about 20, 30 minutes. But we'll just give you a background about the camera's view. Sorry, Ashit, go ahead.
Yeah, so... that was the camera that I got. And it didn't have that dial. And that dial costed about $3,000. And it had to be imported from the UK.
No way.
When I started off, I honestly couldn't afford it, man. Like it was, we were comfortable, but we weren't comfortable enough to buy cameras for, I mean, we weren't
for sure
that comfortable to buy like random things. So for me, gear was a very like I love gear. I don't know how to describe it because I come from a non-art field. So gear was the thing that made the most amount of sense to me. Okay. So, I mean, a lot of photographers go to art school and stuff like that and they kind of get the background of it. But for me, the numbers made more sense, like the camera, the pixels and all of that made more sense. And I think that's also kind of what happens to a lot of photographers nowadays because that makes the most amount of sense to them. So, I mean, yeah, veering away. But this camera basically was, I got it for 5,000 rupees.
Okay.
Second hand. And it was a used camera. And it was the lens was incredible. It was like a Zuiko 1.8.
Oh, 1.8. Okay, nice.
Yeah, I think at that point also, it was more film than digital. I mean, your sensor, right? So, your output was basically defined by mostly your lens and your film.
True.
That was it. Not, I mean, right now it's more sensor. What the camera company can do because there's no autofocus at that point. I mean, I don't know if anybody shot film cam. Most film cameras, beginner cameras didn't have autofocus.
Correct.
What was your first camera?
I am just scrolling to find the picture in the gallery. We have.
Was it like a Nikon FM10?
Yes. Good guess.
Oh, I couldn't afford that. I wanted to buy that, but I couldn't afford it.
Really lucky, my grandfather, who used to practice photography as a hobby, he had a collection, like literally a bag, a thaili, with all his old cameras, with expired roll. Like I'm talking about 100, 200 rolls.
Nice.
3-4 of these lenses and cameras. And I literally was really lucky. Like so I discovered, especially like professional cameras or film cameras in 2006 when I was doing my BMM. And we had... And, you know, in the second year, I had a module in photojournalism. So they asked us to get cameras from home. So most of the people were able to only, you know, pick up like film cameras or point and shoots. No one really had DSLRs. A few were lucky enough to have that. But prior to that, so this was my first film camera. This was my first camera, I would call it.
Oh, I remember this. This is a music phone, right?
It was a music phone, but it had a Carl Zeiss lens. And it was... it had a dedicated shutter button, which was incredible.
Yeah. And,
really, really fun setup. But so this was technically my first ever camera. I made prints with this. It was, I think, 2 megapixel or something like that. But really...
Yeah, like, I had one of these cameras as well. It was not the same phone, but Sony used to make this... what's it, a flip or a I think a rotate... Not the Moto Razr. The...
can't remember.
Yeah, so that was the phone that I had. That was pretty good as well. I think before my OM10, that was the camera I was using. But I wasn't using it for much other than... yeah, I wasn't using it for much. I was like a phone geek at that point.
It was a fun camera. But this was the camera I first used and got my hands dirty on and, you know, like really shot the hell out of it. I shot so much that the mirror stopped working, the shutter stopped working. Uh-huh. Like I used it for like 1 year in my BMM like crazy.
Oh, but yeah, nice.
What did you go from? What was your first digital camera after that?
Oh man, I think it would be like maybe we should do it like brand wise, because if we go chronologically, I think we might get lost somewhere.
I feel like go chronologically, because I just want to see, you know, for especially for people who are starting off and who can't afford to buy the new camera. It's nice to see, okay, from where to where, from film camera to like 100 megapixel, etc.
Yeah. I mean, okay, so let's do that then. Okay, so basically, it was the second camera was a Nikon D100. But at that point, I was kind of assisting somebody, and I saw them use a Kodak DSC Pro. This was a 14 megapixel camera, which in the days of those other cameras. But this was my first digital camera that I owned. Okay. I bought it from this National Geographic photographer called Ryan Lobo, who's really sweet. Yeah, he gave it to me. Like, I didn't pay him upfront for it. He gave me the camera, and I was basically using it. I was paying him a little by little, little by little. And I bought the camera and his laptop.
Oh, okay.
My first MacBook Pro. I mean, MacBook, the white ones. The first one, yeah. And this was, I think, about 7 megapixel. But the reason for me going into the digital was, honestly, the learning time, man. Because it took a lot of time to get that film processed, and it was expensive as well. And I was this is something that at least made sense to me at that point, because I was going on making small expenditures with the film, but it was frequent. Yeah. And for me, it made more sense to kind of go and do this. And fortunately for me, I had somebody who was willing to sell me the camera and me pay him in parts. I honestly, like in the beginning, I wasn't taking help from my parents. So I paid this off really slowly. And I mean, yes, he got annoyed as well, but he was really nice about it. And it took a while for me to pay it off, but he helped me with it. And that's what some of the people I really appreciate, the starting of my career. And this was my first digital camera. The 7 megapixel sensor was, it was something. It was something. What about yours?
I am going to just search mine. It's a very similar story. The Nikon D70S.
70, this came out right after.
So, but this wasn't my camera. This was my friend's camera. His name is Kevin Nunes. And he, so when I got out of photography, got out of college, he kind of pushed me into mentoring a couple of photographers that he used to work under. And at that time, he had just bought his own full frame camera, and he passed this on to me as just saying that keep it, use it for however long you want. And that's what I'm saying. I was so lucky that I wouldn't be able to, afford, even though this camera right now is not worth too much, but at that time it was like a 40-50K, and it was unheard of. Like, thinking of spending that when you're in college is ridiculous. Maybe now it's easier, but
I think it was 60K when it first came out. I remember the pricing. This was also about roughly 7 megapixels, if I'm not wrong.
Six or seven, but such a beautiful camera. So this camera actually got me an award. Okay, so I took part in a competition from Canon, ironically, with the Nikon camera.
It was the Nikon.
Pictures, and I happened to win my first actual camera, which I owned myself and I didn't have to return to anyone, was the 5D Mark II.
Oh, I got the 5D Mark I.
I didn't know, I knew the 5D Mark II had just released like a few months back, but it cost, I think, with the kit lens around 2 lakhs, 2.5 lakhs. I mean, I literally decided, in 5 years or 10 years, I'll be able to afford that. That was my goal. But luckily, things worked out.
Yeah, for me, after the D100, it got some sensor spot in the middle of the thing. And only when you shoot on flash, it would basically show. Okay, it was really weird. And I went to this one more of these gray market places. I mean, I should frequent these gray market places at that point, because looking for cameras and lenses, the cheapest form, right? And I went over there, and this guy saw this camera, and I was like, I wanted to exchange this camera. And he saw the camera. The D100 was actually expensive at that time.
Oh yeah.
It was a pro camera, right? And he was like, okay, let's scam this kid. And I'm just like, And I was like, but I want to exchange it because of the spot on the sensor.
Yeah.
And he, so I said, why don't you check the camera out before like exchanging it? And then he's like, okay, fine, let me check it. He took a couple of pictures. He did all of his checking. And then he like, I think we're supposed to exchange it for a Canon 300D. I don't know if anybody remembers that camera, but that was like 300, 350D, one of those. Yeah. And he basically told me that, so this was like one of the higher end cameras I was exchanging for this, which was the cheapest Canon at that point.
Correct.
And so 8 megapixels, if I remember right. And he was like, but you have to pay me 5,000 rupees more. I was what? Like, but this camera is better. Yeah. And he like, so I was like, okay, he's obviously checked it. He's seen the sensor mark and he's still asking me 5,000. So that must be it, right?
Correct.
And I was like, okay, you know what? We agreed at 4,000 bucks and he gave me this camera.
Mm-hmm.
And I used this camera for a bit and then exchanged this one. I basically got to a point, I shot some really cool stuff on this as well. But then my next camera after this was the 5D Mark I, which was the first full frame 12 megapixel camera at that point, right? Like 12 megapixel, there was nothing that was 12 megapixel. I think the D1H was there, the Nikon, which was, I think, 4 megapixels. And the D1S, which was another, I think, 6 megapixels. So this camera, I shot my first Nike campaign on.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. Yeah.
So it's a really funny story about this camera as well, because I was doing a lot of the smaller work for JWT at that point, like really tiny work. And I saw the Nike 2008 Air Max campaign. I was like, fuck, I want to shoot this. I want to shoot this kind of stuff. Like, I always look at something and be like, I'd like to shoot a campaign like this.
Yeah.
And funnily enough, a few months later, the Nike prototype came to JWT and they're like, listen, we need you to shoot some shots for it. Nice. And because we need to put it into a docket to send out to all the vendors and stuff like that. So for a slideshow, not even a docket. So I was like, okay, cool. So I got the shoes. There was a red shoe and a green shoe. And they basically, while shooting it, I told them, I said, hey, I'm going to shoot this. I'll shoot it like the campaign. Yeah. You don't pay me anything extra, but just pay for the post on it. Like there's some lights had to come out. Nice. And so basically I shot it. So when the campaign had to go up, they had that shot. So what they ended up using was they used that shot as their main shot. And then another big photographer from that time did all the side shots.
No way.
Yeah. And I mean, it's...
Were you working with JWT at that time or were you just...
No. I was walking around begging for work.
That's amazing.
And yeah. And that one shot. And that's when I realized that the megapixel thing, the 12 megapixel printed a board of about 30 feet easy.
That's amazing.
And yeah. And then I was like, wow. What was your next camera after the thing?
I know what you mean in terms of the megapixel thing. You know, I mean, we've all like fallen prey to that whole thing. We need more megapixels. If you're printing big and if you're doing commercial work. Nowadays, there are 400 megapixel cameras if you know, with stitching and stuff like that.
The stacking cameras.
Yeah, but I'm just like, honestly, like my first camera, like the first cameras I used and actually got a print out of was a 6 megapixel or 2 megapixel cameras. And they were doing really well. Of course, yes, if you want the crispest image and you want to crop in. And as a commercial photographer, you know, you want to, sometimes you get like half an hour, 1 hour with like a celebrity or, someone who, we have like a limited amount of time in the year with. So you shoot and later on need to crop in and use the pictures in various mediums. So then it's kind of justifiable to have like 100 megapixels, 50 megapixels, etc. But honestly, for most people, unless you're doing hoardings or doing actual commercial work, I think 12, 16, 18 megapixels is more than enough. 20 megapixels?
Yeah, no, because I feel like even the hoarding work right now, it gets done within like 24, 25 megapixels. Because what is the resolution of film if you really look at it in comparison to digital, right? You're looking at maybe what 21, 22 megapixel is what film's resolution used to be. I mean, of course, the pixels were a little bit more rounded off, but that's kind of the threshold of where film's thing was. So, but that's what I don't understand. Like, I think a lot of the companies kind of marketed because they want you to upgrade. They want you to feel like your camera's kind of inferior as well to a certain extent so that you upgrade. I mean, that's what iPhone does to your iPhone. Like, if you notice around when your iPhone launches, suddenly your old iPhone has a few bugs and it starts to go a little bit slower, right? And that's what, I mean, that's kind of what the marketing aspect of it. But I still don't think you need more than 25 megapixels to shoot commercial. And if you're giving bleed space around your thing where they crop in and stuff like that, yeah. I think 50 is still good. Yeah. And I mean, 50 is perfect.
Is more than enough, yeah.
Yeah, because I mean, it's also, I mean, maybe it's something we don't remember, but when we were shooting billboards back in the day, I think also the printing has changed. Maybe the printing was different at that point. Maybe what we were looking at wasn't as high res as what we're looking at right now. So, I mean, that's, again, it's debatable according to distance from the person and all of that, but how much can you actually go, right? But yeah, the 12 megapixel camera made me realize that you can shoot a billboard with that camera. That was my first full frame camera, and I love that camera. I did a lot of really great work that I'm still proud of with that camera.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The work that you remember for the rest of your career, and
yeah,
was not the actual.
That's where I think the Canon color science also comes into like the entire thing of color science that we've been talking about, right?
True.
They did that right from the beginning.
Very true.
Like it may have not been the more the higher megapixel, I mean the higher dynamic range, which I kind of understood a little later, but right. It was just the pictures, and that's why a lot of Canon photographers also right now, their pictures out of camera look really nice.
Correct. Exactly.
But when you go into post and you try to push that file, it's not going anywhere. I mean, from where you are, it may extend to another 25%, but that's about it.
True. Whereas with a Sony or a Fuji medium format,
yeah.
You can go crazy. You can actually,
yeah.
which is, I felt for myself, especially, I found it really bad in some ways because I, when you have limited control, then you can kind of go up and down like 10% and you're like, okay, you know, the picture looks good. But when you have like 70% control of the image, you tend to go a little crazy in post. So
yeah, no, and like, yeah. At that point also, I don't know if you remember, but around the 5D Mark II point,
yeah.
A lot of people are using medium format cameras. So like when we're trying to step up our game, right? So like your Suresh Natarajan was using Hasselblad CM and a phase one back. Tarun Kewal was using only Hasselblad and a phase one back. So that entire thing got into me as well. I was like, dude,
yeah.
I want this now. And
right.
And I mean, I think people should also understand at these points when we had these cameras, yeah, that was the back for the camera. That was the camera, yeah. So, and then I sold my 5D, which I think is still the stupidest thing that I did at that point for this camera.
Okay.
The Hasselblad 500cm. And I got this camera and I had one lens, a 45mm f4 lens. And this was a manual focus camera.
Okay.
And honestly, if you don't know about medium format cameras, I mean, how they are right now is very different.
Correct.
But back then, it was a pain in the ass to use this camera. And if you look down the viewfinder, right? So you're looking at a mirrored image.
Correct.
Like horizontally mirrored. So if you want to pan your camera to the right, I mean, if you're looking at something and you want to pan it to the right, you technically need to pan it to the left.
It can make you dizzy. Yeah. It can make you dizzy for the first time.
Yeah. And after I got this camera, I stopped shooting on handheld because I couldn't. Like it was so frustrating and confusing. I was like, I put it on a tripod, and I had to have a laptop connected. So this was the point where I had to have a laptop connected. You couldn't see anything from the back.
True.
That damn screen was so shit. It was so shit. Like I think there were cell phones with better screens than that at that point, and this back. At that point, in 2009 or 2010, costed me, I mean, 6.5 lakhs. And this was, yeah, it was ridiculous. Again, at this point, this dealer was like, you know, huh?
How many megapixels was it?
This was a P30 Plus. So it was a 30 megapixel camera at that point. And it wasn't even a new one. This was a secondhand rate.
Wow.
Yeah, it was. I think a new one was about 12 lakhs or 13 lakhs at that point.
So, phase 10 has been like ruling the back market. Huh? It's been.
Yeah, they had the H backs first, which were basically you had to shoot with a laptop. You couldn't shoot.
Got it.
I think these are the P backs, which are portable. And they had a battery and a screen, which is the shittiest screen in the world. But it worked to a certain extent for a lot of photographers. I think. Also, a lot of the larger photographers are shooting tethered all the time and they had clients that wanted to see it, right?
True.
And the funny thing about this camera also, when I bought it, was I was shooting something that Tarun Kewal had shot the main campaign for.
Got it.
And I was shooting a supplementary campaign, and they were looking at the 5D images and going, why is it not as sharp as this?
Oh, okay.
And I was like, you're paying him a lot more. His camera's worth a lot more. I mean, it wasn't even like a lighting thing at that point. They were like megapixel this much. And that's when the entire conversation starts off. Right? When we're kind of starting off, this entire megapixel thing is very important.
Yeah.
And that's why I bought this camera.
So, and, coming to megapixel, the craze, I'm just going to rush through this because it's already been half an hour since we have been starting to talk about this.
But
this is the, this, I think you also own the D800.
And oh, yeah.
I also own the D800, and that was my next camera after the 5D. And there was a friend, Advait, who had the D800. He was a Nikon guy, and I was like, dude, I hate Nikon colors. I'm never going to switch to Nikon.
Same.
And I saw the sharpness. I saw the dynamic range. I did a full comparison of days, and I was like, dude, okay. You know what? And at that time, I started shooting cars. I started shooting a lot of cars, and the 5D was doing okay, the 5D Mark II. But in terms of dynamic range, what you could do, because there's a limit to how much you can light and how much you can kind of, you know, spend time on while lighting on set.
There was a conversation a lot about that time that it's not like film. That the film dynamic range, I don't know if you remember this, and that's what they used to talk about. So it was like, it didn't have the dynamic range as film. That was a conversation between analog photographers and digital photographers. But I remember this, and I always tried Nikon cameras, but I never liked the color thing because I think also coming from Canon, it became a little bit more easier. Yeah, it was spoiled. Like the 5D was brilliant.
Exactly. I mean, just in terms of, when I used a 5D Mark II a few days back, a friend's camera, just playing around with it. And that with a simple, like now you can pick it up for like 25-30K. You use 5D Mark II with like a 51.8 cost, less than 50K.
Oh, wow.
And it still produces really good colors and skin tones, and everything looks like just easy to use. So, like, you know, for someone who is like probably, I don't know, like a blogger or influencer or someone who's shooting like food, like a food stylist, or someone who's starting off who doesn't want to like invest in a lot of stuff, buy a used camera, buy a used full frame camera.
Yeah, no, the 5D Mark I also, I'd say like if you can get like a 51.4 on it, it was really quick on 4K as well. Like, correct. It's just, but I mean, single, now we talk about, yeah.
It was a single?
No, I think it had nine.
Nine, yeah.
It had
nine. Yeah.
I mean, not in the hundreds, but nine, single digit nine. But yeah, that was, I mean, I still think you can use that. And this camera was, I think, what, 36 megapixels?
Was 36 megapixels. And more than the resolution, I think it just the sharpness and...
it didn't have the anti-aliasing filter.
Without the anti-aliasing filter. And that was like, that was a big thing. That was a big deal.
I think they had an anti-aliasing filter and a 800E, which didn't have it.
The E didn't have it, yeah. The D800 had it. But still, it was crazy sharp. It was,
and I think that's when. So I should do a lot of talking, like studying about sensor technology and where it came from at that point. So prevalent to the, I think so. Sony making the sensor. I think the D800, if I'm not mistaken, was Sony. Yeah. But Kodak used to make a lot of the sensors for medium format and still cameras. And yeah, so I think this was kind of the shift of who was manufacturing the sensors for the cameras.
Correct. And that's how then Sony then entered. And this was at least my next camera. I'm just showing the size difference first. Between
what
the
is Sony. That?
It was the
oh,
one
shit.
Versus the Sony A7. The original Sony A7. That's the sizing difference. That
I think around that time, I think you had the A7 and then the A7R. The original one, right?
Yeah. And and then the A7S.
So I think when you had the A7R, that I think that's kind of why, when we became friends on Facebook, right? That was it.
In Facebook, maybe. No, maybe Instagram. I think we first connected on Instagram, I'm not sure.
Huh. So I think around that time was when I was looking at Sony as well. So it was really funny because I think I saw yours and then I was like, I had gone to meet them and then the Sony team had sent me a Sony A7 II to test. And it had just launched. And I was like, okay, this makes more sense. But then I was like, megapixel. And the R had 36, the same as the Nikon.
Same as the D800.
So, D800.
I picked it up because I was like, I need a backup camera. Huh. And this, why not try this? And I think I was one of the first three people in India to buy the Sony camera. And then I used it for 3-4 months as a backup camera. And one day on set, I was with a friend who was assisting me. And he was shooting some behind the scenes with it, and I just asked to borrowed the camera with the kit lens. I had the D800 with the big 2470, 7200. And I switched and the client was petrified. He was like, oh my God, what is happening? You know, my being shot by the small toy camera. But I was shocked at how good the results were. They were as sharp or maybe sharper than the D800. The glass was smaller. It was quicker. The autofocus wasn't as good. The battery life was pretty bad.
It was shit. It was really shit.
But otherwise, what an impressive camera. I think this was one of the, like, after the 5D Mark II, this was a 5D Mark I. This was quite a revolution.
That's the A7R, right? The original one.
Yeah. I mean, the basically, in general, the A7 series, which was the first full-frame mirrorless cameras that launched by any brand. So,
I mean, my entry into Sony was also like around that time where we were kind of having this conversation about what the 36 megapixel thing and all. I was like, Nikon doesn't work for me. And this mirrorless technology really, for me, was more about the fact that the EVF, where we wouldn't have to have a laptop while we were thinking. So we're outdoor. The thing is, with those screens behind the camera, if you thought your exposure was fine, you're probably off by one stop sometimes. And like if you increase the thing. So that was a big thing for me. And I was testing out the A7 II, and I was deciding between the A7 II and the A7R. Okay. And I think when I was about to make the dive into it is when the A7 R2 launched. So like, it was literally a day into it and the A7 R2 launched. Got and it. I was like, dude, I want this camera. And that was a really good camera. But I, again, like you, I never trusted it. I was like, okay, fine. Let's use it for smaller work, the stuff that I can do on the side and all that. And I used to always rent a medium format camera for my campaigns. And this used to be a backup. So, I knew it was faster, but I would never trust it to do a campaign.
Correct.
And the funny thing is, I was doing a break bounce campaign, and we had a medium format, and we had this camera, both shooting the same thing. And I was using an A7 R2 with a Metabones adapter with a Canon 1635. Correct. And I had a Godox XT trigger, and I had a Profoto trigger on top of that. So, I mean, at that point, you're shooting with the medium format. I was like, it's too slow. Like, it's working too slow. And I just literally put that camera down. I plugged in my A7R and I started shooting with the A7R.
Yeah.
And the campaign pictures that we used for that, we had both. We had the medium format and we had the A7R pictures. And it turned out the A7R II pictures were more, they had more movement. They had more energy. It was more dynamic at that point. And the dynamic range really matched the thing. Again, I didn't trust it. But I was like, okay, fine. These guys, the agency, like, we want this picture. I'm like, okay, fine. It went to get cleaned up and all of that. And it went on a billboard. Yeah. And oh my God, the clarity that I saw from that. I didn't even trust it until I saw it on the billboard.
Yeah.
And that was mad. That was, I think that's where I kind of believe that mirrorless is the way forward.
Yeah. So even for me, I think, it was probably seeing it side by side on a big, you know, big screen is when I realized, you know what, I think I'm going to make the switch. And again, within 2 years of owning the Nikon, I sold the Nikon and I invested all my money into the Sony system. So I bought a 1635, 2470, 7200. I had the A7R Mark I and I bought the A7S, which it didn't make sense because I wasn't shooting video, but it was so crazy. Again, this is going to be very difficult to see on the small screen next to my head. But the ISO performance on that, man, it was ridiculous.
4 lakh or something like that, right? Or 1 lakh. Was it 1 lakh or 4 lakh?
4 lakh. It went up to 4 lakh. And at that time, I'm not joking. Like, I was blown. I just bought that camera for the ISO performance, even though it was only 12 megapixels, even though I didn't shoot commercially at all. I just bought it as a backup camera. And if you see on the left, that's a D800 at max ISO. That's an A7 II at max ISO. And that's the A7S, the original A7S at max ISO. And you see the skin tones. You see that, I mean, from here, it looks like a clean picture. So this was a big, big deal. This was like, I mean, even now, I think the A7S series is the best in terms of noise performance, etc.
Yeah, no, I think also like the initial sensors that Sony came up with were a little bit more, like they had a little bit more weight than the newer sensors that are coming out.
Yeah.
So like even the sensors inside the GFX, the 50S, right? That's a proven sensor. That's like the R6 engine of cameras, right?
Yeah.
So it's like it was used in the what do you say, the phase ones. It was used in the, and this was CMOS. They used a lot of CCD technology first with medium format, and I mean, it was kind of like after the, I think Sony's, it was, I actually got out of Sony because of a really weird reason, because I wasn't getting good service from Sony at that point.
Yeah.
So like, I don't think other than you and me, anybody was shooting commercial work at Sony at all at that point.
True.
But I didn't get my service, and I was like, you know what? And I was eyeing the GFX. As soon as it became available in India, I went and bought it.
Yeah.
I was like, I called my camera dealer, this guy Naresh in Bangalore. So yeah, support small stores, Naresh in Bangalore and Kashish in Bombay.
Yes.
And so I think, so Naresh helped me with this camera, and I got it. And I think the weird thing is I've never used Lightroom.
Okay.
And Lightroom, I'm sorry, but for me is really, it's not very intuitive, because, and the colors that come out of it are just like really weird for me. I don't know about how anybody else works, but for me, I've been using Capture One for like over a decade now.
Yeah, wow. And
yeah, I've been using it since the Phase One camera. So the Phase One camera.
Yeah, I just switched with the GFX. Huh. I was using Capture One. I was using Lightroom, mix of Photoshop, Lightroom, and couple other importers. But otherwise, after I switched to Capture One, I can understand what you're talking. But also, Capture One had a lot of bugs earlier. There was constant crashing, constant ejection of cables.
That was dependent on which camera you used. So okay. Like the Canons used to have that happen to quite often. The Nikons, little less.
Okay.
But so it was, again, I love Capture One. Capture One, if you ask me what is the one thing I can't do commercial work without, it's Capture One. Like anything else, I can still supplement it. Like lights, I can supplement one brand with another. Cameras, I can still supplement one brand with another. But my raw processing, I'm dependent on Capture One. Like I'm hooked on.
I can agree.
But that's the funny thing about this camera as well, right? So when I first got it, I tried to use Lightroom and I hated it.
Yeah.
And then I was like, I was trying to find out the workaround to use the Phase One, the Fuji GFX 50S with Lightroom. I mean, with Capture One.
Yeah.
And I couldn't. Like it was, they had like these different converters. I don't know if you've been through that phase, but you could download an app where it'll shoot into the app, then they convert it into a DNG file.
Yeah, man. So annoying.
Yeah. So I tried that and it didn't work. And then I was shooting on a campaign and it just kept crashing. And I was like, I can't handle this. I'm throwing this camera. I called my dealer. I said, please, I do not want this stupid shit anymore. Yeah. I can't do it. I mean, a camera is useless without its software. Let's just understand that. And I was like, I can't do professional work like this. My clients think I'm just an amateur coming to a thing with something that doesn't work.
Yeah. So that's the worst thing. That is my worst nightmare. Like, I'm okay with lights conking off. I'm okay with things happening. But otherwise, when the cable gets on getting disconnected, it's my pet peeve. I hate it. I want to kill someone. Yeah.
You know, and that was my case. I was just like, I can't do this. And I called him. I said, listen, take this camera back. I don't want it. He like, but you just bought it. I was like, but I can't do any commercial work. What's the point? And he's like, okay, let me get somebody to call you from Fuji. And somebody called me from Fuji. And he's like, and this was around Photokina. And
okay.
I was like, dude, this is not working for me. And like, I'm a Capture One guy and I can't do this. Is there a workaround that you know about? He's like, no, there's no workaround. I was like, okay, fine. I'm returning the camera. He's like, no, don't do it. I was like, what do you mean? He's like, no, don't do it. Wait 2 days.
Okay.
I was like, what do you mean wait 2 days? That's not a very specific answer. He's like, sir, I can't tell you, but I'm asking you to wait 2 days.
Okay,
and
that's
2 days later was when Fuji announced their partnership with Capture One.
Damn. Okay, wow.
Yeah, that was when it happened. And I was just like, and then the next shoot that I did, and it was part of the same shoot. So I think we're shooting on a Thursday, Friday with Max, the brand.
Yeah.
And then we are doing a Monday, Tuesday schedule. And it happened on the weekend. And that, what do you say, that software, when I used the GFX the first time with Capture One, I was just sitting there and going, shit.
Yeah,
this
really
is so good. And I had I was using the 45 f/2.8 lens,
which
is still one of my favorite lenses to date. It is a Sazen of autofocus.
Yeah.
But it's just, I was just like, the colors, it reminded me of what I felt when I had my 5D. And yeah, it was just the picture looked good. There was no, I mean, to tweak it and then the
work put into the, you know, initial presets and stuff like that.
And that's what I found a lot with Sony's. With Sony, we did so much work to get it to baseline, and then from baseline, you had to take it up.
Correct.
And that's a part that I think kind of turned me off Sony as well, because once I saw this, I was like, but there's nothing to it. There's no work. And they implemented the, what do you say, the film presets and stuff like that.
Oh my God. I really missed that about the Fuji.
Yeah, that was love at first sight. And I was like, okay, you know what, this makes sense for me. I think both of us had the camera about the same time as well.
Yeah, no, and you bought it earlier. I bought it, I think, a year later. You bought it, if you're saying around Photokina, then you bought it around 2017. I got it in 2018, I bought it in 2019.
I think around, but it was already a year old before, I think we kind of figured it out.
So, I was in New York for something, and I just walked into B&H. And at that time, this was the first time, like, I'd seen the FX had just launched in 2017. And I was like, oh my God, that's light. That's really, really lightweight. And I had a 1D Expo around my waist. And I was like, dude, this is crazy. But I tested it out, shot a couple of portraits. I found the camera a little slow because I was used to the 1DX.
Yeah.
But I didn't give it too much of thought at that time. But who knew, like 2 years later, I would own the same camera.
Yeah, no, but the funny thing about that was, so when I first saw it, right? And I was just like, in my own heart, this was the camera that I wanted. Like, I loved medium format because of what it could do with the files.
Yeah.
But it was never feasible because it was just too slow to work with. It was slowing me down. And this camera came out.
The cost is a big thing.
Yeah, it is. And it was huge. And this was, I mean, when it first came out, it was about 5 lakhs in India, which is nothing in compared to a medium format. Like, the same body from, I think, phase one with the camera and a lens was about, I think, 9 lakhs. And that was like already 4 or 5 years old with phase one. And it made sense. And then that I got two lenses, a 63 and a 45.
Right.
And the 45, it was slow. It was slow autofocus, yes, compared to a DSLR.
Yeah.
But in comparison to a medium format, it was blazing fast.
Right.
And that's the weirdest thing I can still say is if it was slow, but if it said focused on a Fuji GFX, it is focused.
Exactly.
With Sony, you still is doubtful. With Canon, it's always doubtful.
with DSLRs in general nowadays, I mean, going back to a DSLR is like, it's a little difficult for me to even think about it. But Sony's eye autofocus, face detection, all that has really, really improved. I would say now, I mean, honestly, even when I pass on a camera to like my wife, like just shoot pictures of one of our cats or something else, I mean, she's not ever struggling with focus. You know, it's just like, tap to focus like a normal cell phone, or sometimes it just, you don't need to tap, it just like locks on the eye. And even with my cats and stuff, it just locks on the eye. So since we have just a couple of minutes more before we start taking questions, I'm just going to run through I had the 1DX, I had the Sony, then I had the 1DX, then I had the Sony again, then the 1DX.
I remember that.
A7R, A7R4, but anyway, so then I owned the GFX as well. Beautiful camera, amazing. Found it.
And then the 100 came.
Ashit still owns the 100 with the GFX 50 as well. We bought the X3 for video.
I have the X3 as well.
Yeah, but I switched then to very controversially from Fuji 100 megapixels back to a Sony. What is it? How many megapixels? 60 megapixels.
Yeah.
So I kind of downgraded in a way, but for various...
No, I mean, the GFX camera is a brilliant camera, but honestly, it's a little bit too far ahead in terms of how it works to the technology that we have in terms of laptops and stuff like that right now. Because it was, I don't know where it was throttling for me, but while I was shooting outdoors, it slowed me down. And that was a problem for me. And with the 50S, it's just like...
I remember like you telling me, so you have the GFX 100 in your bag, but you still pull out the 50S for most shoots, which sounds like why?
No, I shoot exclusively on the 50S right now. Up until Apple doesn't come out with the... And the reason that I remember talking to you about this as well, the reason that I bought the camera was to be future-proof. for it to make sense for a couple of years. Yeah. And I still think that in a year, when the laptops get a little bit better, the camera will be a little bit better as well. And that camera will last for another 5 to 6 years for sure. My concern is, like, coming back to all of that, right? I don't think we need more than 50 megapixels. That's my point right now. Because it's 50 megapixel on the thing as well. It's so good. That sensor is maybe about 7-8 years old, but it's so good.
For sure. So even when I was switching away from the GFX, also a lot of people asked me why I sold the GFX. One of the main reasons was it was such a beautiful camera and such an expensive camera and so big that I ended up just keeping it in my dry cabinet most of the times. I didn't use it for most of the stuff. And I am a commercial photographer. I shoot professionally. That's how I make my living. But we don't shoot every day, you know. I like carrying my camera. I like shooting my cats. I like going to the terrace, shooting sunsets. I like, you know, traveling with my camera. And that camera, even though the image quality is, you can't compare to anything on the market yet. I feel like I had to get rid of it because I wanted something more compact, something more usable. And now I literally own the A7 R4 with the 24-105. Yeah.
That's my version of the compact travel camera.
So yeah, first of all, when you have a big camera, even when I had the 1DX or with the GFX, I had to buy the X-T3 or I had to buy an RX100 or the Fuji X100B because you needed something small and compact because these cameras are so big and bulky. And also, I mean, if you're lugging around your neck, you're lugging around like 10 lakhs or 8 lakhs worth of stuff, you're scared to carry it around. You know, you don't want get robbed or mugged or whatever. So
yeah, I mean, I think as photographers also, we hear a lot of stories of how people have been robbed. And like, I know people on shoot, like I didn't take my GFX to Cape Town with me this time because somebody's camera bag got whacked from a shoot. So the GFX 50S is kind of in a space right now for me where I'll put it to anything. But again, to date, it's still one of my favorite cameras. I mean, it is my favorite camera, followed closely by the 5D.
Makes sense.
And this beauty, man, like, I'll loan you this camera.
Never tried all the Ricohs.
You should. Like it's a stupid expensive compact camera. It's unnecessary. It's but
28mm?
It's a 28mm fixed lens. But when I bought it for about 70k in India. And it was a luxury buy. It definitely is. But it's for what it is, to walk around and stuff like that, it's superb. And the Ricohs, the Pentax, have really good their own color science. Even though they're not very popular, their color science is also pretty great.
I love and especially love what a fixed lens camera does to your composition and your vision. I love, you know, just carrying around. Like even for me, it was the X100 series. So that camera really like propelled me towards shooting thoughtfully, and also. It was my first experience with Fujifilm film simulations.
That's kind of like, you know, it kind of takes me back because Fuji is doing, okay, so everybody needs to understand right now that I think other than Canon and Ricoh, all cameras are running with the same sensors made by Sony, which are wired in different ways, which have different applications and stuff like that. What Fuji is doing with their color science to the sensor is something that is... and. It's very comparable, or if not better, than Canon's sensors.
For sure. I would say now Fuji is on the top. Controversially, I'm going to say Sony's second. Okay, there are a lot of comparisons, but I
sensor-wise, yeah.
No, in terms of color science as well. The A7 R4. I know a very controversial statement. I
agree. I think it's very controversial. That's what I agree on.
But that's the A7 R4 is because after doing a lot of testing, I realized Fuji is still very, very accurate in terms of its colors. It just looks nice, but the Sony did a much better job than the EOS R. When I was comparing the cameras before buying the Sony, I had both of them for a few days, and the Sony just killed it in terms of autofocus, battery life.
Yeah, it's mad.
And stuff like that. The color science was better on the Sony, which is I never thought I would say this, but yeah.
I think, but there's a very thing about that, right? So basically, they have this new S Cine Tone that's coming out with it's come down from the Venice to now the FX9.
Yeah,
that's kind of like they moved away from having the perfect picture in their minds to kind of having an imperfect picture that looks good. And yeah. that's kind of what it needs to be. Like, I don't think Fuji is trying to make the perfect picture. I don't think Canon is trying to make the perfect picture. They're trying to make something that makes sense. Honestly, I think Sony should just hire some Kodak engineers and start to introduce their old films.
Hire us, man. Sony and I, just hire us. We'll do a good job.
Hey, no. I hire you. I'm not very good at this. I sit and bitch the entire day. That's all.
Since we have like 5 minutes left, guys, you can ask the questions. Sorry for keeping the comments off, but it was hiding Ashit's face. Okay, Ashit, first question. I think Krisha asked the first question. So you both have probably lived through the evolution of photography to iPhone-nography. What do you think of that?
I don't think that iPhones are up to where a professional digital camera is right now. It will be in the future. There's no doubt about that. It's just an evolution. But I don't think it is there right now. I think maybe another 2 years we should be there where people will be using it commercially. And I know that people are using it commercially for Instagram and stuff like that. But it's also, definitely the output. If you're looking at a build, gives you enough control. But if you're looking at like a screen, I think an iPhone is good enough.
So I think the iPhone is or any good phone camera is good enough for most people, especially for just posting to Instagram. I think you can just survive with the phone. You don't really need a camera unless you're obviously doing commercial. You're getting paid for your picture quality, and you're getting paid for making prints, or you're getting paid for... Basically, if you want a lot of control, obviously the cameras are much better, or DSLR, any DSLR is better than the iPhone. But with this whole computational photography, with stabilized
lenses,
portrait mode, I think most people, like, if you're just an influencer shooting, you know, pictures of yourself, which you should be, I think an iPhone is more than enough.
Yeah, if you're an absolute beginner, I think you're better off doing it with an iPhone. If you want to be a professional photographer, then get something that with an interchangeable lens, something like that.
Yeah. Okay, what's your current favorite camera? This, I guess, keeps on changing for each year for everyone now. But what's your favorite camera? The 50S or the 100?
50S, man. It has my heart. Like, it's just that and this. This is something that I would recommend to anybody who can afford it.
No, one camera on a standard on an island, what camera would you choose? What camera and lens?
If I was standing on an island, there'd be no commercial work, so I'd take this.
What's my favorite camera? I think the Sony A7 R4. I mean, at least currently, the A7 R4 does whatever I need it to do. So I'm happy using it. Whatever pictures you've seen in the last like 3-4 months, or even before that, before the lockdown, has been all shot on the Sony. How do you make most of, if you own an old system like the 5D Mark III? I think the 5D Mark III is not
that old.
Yeah. I think invest in lenses. You don't need to upgrade the body unless you have like a specific need for like 4K video or really fast autofocus or et cetera, et cetera. I think the 5D Mark III is still capable enough.
So yeah, but that's the flip side, is I'd say maybe invest in good glass, not multiple lenses. Maybe like, because the thing is also with what's happening with Canon is they're moving to the mirrorless format, and that's what's going to happen in the next couple of years. So big buys in the old system will probably not help you as much. True. But I'd say maybe, a lens, a really good lens is the better way to go to understand what you can really pull out of your camera versus just going and buying something.
Correct. Okay, quickly, we have like a minute left. What's the verdict if you were to blindly pick up any camera for a photo shoot now? For me, it's the Sony. Ashit, for you? Any camera.
Blind, what kind of shoot is it?
that's a good question.
Because if you ask me to shoot sports, it's a different camera. If you ask me to shoot still campaign, so right now, if it was a running campaign, I'd choose the Sony A9. Any other campaign, pretty much the GFX 50S.
Okay. Literally the last, I'm going to count down now.
Should we just come back and just do like a 10-minute session?
If I don't know how to join the videos, then it's going to be like two different videos. So it's going to be a little difficult to say that, especially if you want to put that anywhere else. Okay. Any thoughts, Basar, and upcoming Canon cameras?
The EOS R5 is gotten me all tingling in the pants.
Let's see. I'm excited to see as well. I mean, honestly, the brand doesn't matter.
Yeah. Let's,
I'm just for camera innovation. So if you can come out with a good camera, I'll switch.
If they come out with 4K raw video, I think that would be set. I mean, 8K it doesn't make sense to me right now. 4K, if oversampled 4K raw is, I'll probably like look at getting one.
Quickly tell us the aspect of dynamic range. That's a long conversation. probably for another session. Save that for another question. Session, please. How do you get started in commercial photography? Again, you know, we save that for another session. Best travel camera for me is my iPhone. Or even the Sony nowadays is pretty compact. Yeah.
This looks like an ad for the GR2.
But yeah, I think that's it. I think we have, yeah, I think that's about it. I think it's going to end anytime soon. But yeah, if you all have any other questions or any other ideas for the next session, let us know. DM me or Rashid. And we'll do this. We'll do this like once a week. I think it's a fun thing to do, especially, you know, when work is kind of slow right now.
Yeah.
Good to kind of talk about stuff and be excited about cameras and stuff. Okay, Shrikant has a question. Ashish, wouldn't production teams get any camera needed? Why would you need to invest in your own camera?
So it's kind of like, how much time do we have?
We have like, yeah, a few, like 30 seconds. It's not still showing me the countdown, but yeah.
Because so, okay. I'd say, I mean, that's a very good question. I wouldn't say invest in a camera unless you are doing enough work with it. And for me, to invest in my own cameras, it made sense because I didn't like using rental cameras because sometimes they were like beat up. They were, the cable parts were loose. And again, for me, it's really important with the kind of work that I do specifically. I can't have my equipment fail on me. That's a very big part for me. I don't know about anybody else. I mean, starting up as well, you can kind of deal with it.
I mean, but that's a problem. It leaves such a bitter taste in your client's mind that, you know, you'll never be hired again.
Won't work with you again. Yeah.
Yeah, work with you. If your camera fails, it's not your fault because you're paying someone, you're paying a rental guy, but you have to understand, he's making 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees a day from your camera. You're getting paid lakhs a day. You can't afford to, you know, have your camera, you know, run the risk of failing or your battery running out, memory card being corrupt. That's why, same here, I can't use rental cameras unless I have a backup of my own.
Yeah, so I'd say maybe like, I mean, the days of renting medium formats also are gone. It's just, I mean, yeah, especially with the GFX 50S, it's so cheap, man. Like right now, I think you can get one for about 3 lakhs.
Yeah, 3.2 or something, 3.25
But again, it's a very specific camera for a very specific job. I wouldn't recommend it for a beginner. I'd say maybe like look at the A7 R3 is a good camera. The A7 III is a good camera. The EOS R is a good camera. Fuji's X-T4, I think, is going to be brilliant.
My problem with the X-T series, and honestly, it wasn't about the full frame APS-C you know, issue that most people complain about. I don't care about that, honestly. The problem was I need more megapixels if I'm doing commercial work. The 26 megapixels wasn't cutting it. And I tried, you know, I was very happy with the camera and simulation, whatever, the 4K 60 internal, etc. for video. But I need higher megapixels. Like, I need at least 40 megapixels or 36 megapixels from doing commercial work. So
I agree. I got spoiled as well with the GFX. I mean, I only use my X-T3 for only video work. And that's how I kind of see it right now. I look at it as photography work, like mid-range, where you kind of just get started up, or if you're doing products or something like that, it's great. But professional work, I'd say go to the GFX range, unless Fuji comes out with one, like a X100, but a full-frame version.
I don't think, man. I really don't think.
You know what? Even if they came up with that camera for a medium format, I'd just go and buy it.
I know you would switch. You are a...
I'm a one-lens kind of guy, so like, I don't... Yeah. Like, for me, just fast focus and the leaf shutter is a big thing for me. The sync speed.
Okay, we have like 30 seconds left, so I don't think it makes sense answering any questions.
So we'll upload this onto our